nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 3.15. So we were just talking about various features that MEEP has in terms of geometries and materials. Now we're going to look at it a little differently and actually go back to what we had studied in Unit 1 and revisit the topic of photonic band structures. So if you recall, in that unit, we were seeking solutions to this master equation, which is listed here, which is essentially a combination of Maxwell's equations. And so this kind of system, if it's in a periodic medium, has what's called a block solution. And this block solution for the magnetic field H has product of two terms, a periodic function with the same period as the periodicity that's imposed on the system times a plane wave. And so we always wrote that basically as e to the ik dot r times u of r. And remember that, again, u of r can be broken down into a representation in the Fourier domain. So then oftentimes you get sum over something like h sub g times e to the ik plus g dot r. Okay, so that's just a recap. But then how do we actually do this in finite difference time domain? You might think that's not even possible because we're not operating in the frequency domain, we're operating in time domain. But if you recall from the ring resonator example, we actually showed explicitly that you can calculate the frequency of resonance. And so it stands to reason that if you can calculate a resonant frequency, you could also calculate an eigenmode frequency in very similar fashion using filter diagonalization. So now we're going to try that for a particular structure which is periodic and lossless instead of something that had loss like before. And so what you see here is actually that we have a definition of just the geometry and materials that would go into this waveguide. You can kind of see here, this is the base element, which has a certain width W, which is defined here. And then we have a whole radius, which of course, you know, has a diameter of 2R. And then we have like a relatively large size for this system. And then we assume that it's going to be periodic in the X direction. And that was basically imposed by this size 1SY. And then when we set up the PML layers actually ensure that they're only in the y direction. So in the x direction, it just repeats over and over again. So although you only see one subunit, you can actually just assume infinite number that are repeated to the x direction, right? Both in minus and plus x. And then we have to set up the source, of course, just like in any other FTDD simulation, which is of course different from something like MIT photonic bands. And then we create a pulse frequency width. In this case, it's extremely wide because we want to capture all the modes in one sweep, right? Rather than try to do one frequency at a time, which would take really long time to run. And then here we basically would set up the source, and it has HZ components. You can see that all of these modes will basically be transverse electric or TE. And then we can actually even simplify the system a little more to impose a mirror plane symmetry, which is odd. So then if we only want to look at odd modes, we can do that. Or we could, of course, impose a phase of plus one in the y direction. So that would only give us even modes. And then we can actually impose a k vector. So then this k vector, of course, can only be imposed really in the periodic directions. So in the aperiodic direction, the y direction, we basically assign a ky of zero because there's really no point in assigning any k value. So as you can see, of course, that means that it's going to be a 1D band structure, not a 2D band structure. And then we're going to run the sources over these different k values. And so you can actually see that at each of these k points, we could actually run a different value of k, like kind of interpolated over this list from kx equals 0 to kx equals 0.5. And so here's kind of the output that you'll get for this sort of system. So you can see here in the x direction, this is the kx value. And we're basically going like all the way to the edge of the Berlin zone, which is at 0.5 in the reduced units. Remembering that period is 1, so that means that the Berlin zone boundary in reduced units is 0.5, or more precisely 0.5 times 2 pi over a, because 2 pi over a is the default k unit. And so that's like a pi over a. So that's very similar to what we saw early in unit 1, actually. If you forgot, then you may want to check that again. And then you can see that actually I have two regions in this band structure, one that's light and one that's dark. And so the one that's dark is called the light cone. And so this, like the escape cone for light, where basically kx is small enough so that any mode that was guided in the high index structure could escape into air. Anything below the light line, which is this diagonal line here, and you can see that doesn't look like a 45 degree slope just because of the way I plotted it, but of course it basically is a 45 degree slope in practice, would basically, anything below this would be wave guided, right? So it's index guided mode, and so it's not going to escape. And so fortunately in this kind of simulation, you can pick up both these index-guided wave modes, which would have very high quality factor, or maybe even like effectively infinite quality factor, as well as these modes above the light line that, of course, would be very leaky and lossy. So that's like actually one of the advantages of this sort of modeling, that you can capture both the lossy and eigenmodes of the system in the same simulation. And you can see also you're capturing a very broad range of modes. So if you have like lots of modes that are closely spaced, using harminth is very powerful. And you can actually extract for each of the kx values. You can see here kx equals 0.325, like all the real and imaginary frequency components. And you can actually either plot them here. So of course, I've plotted only the real components here, but you can also plot the losses. And you can actually verify for yourself as an exercise that these parts are going to be lossy and these should be very, very low loss. In the next lecture, we'll go into more details about how to use band structures.